Hi, and welcome to episode one of Think Like a Hacker. This is a regular podcast that my colleague Kathy Zant and I are going to be co-hosting. And today we have an amazing show for you. The title of this podcast is Think Like a Hacker. And the reason we called it that is because one of the things that we do at Wordfence is teach our users, customers, and friends to think like a hacker so they can better defend themselves. But there's another aspect of thinking like a hacker, or hackerdom, which is innovation. And innovation is something that I'm very passionate about, and I think a lot of folks that I'm friends with in the WordPress community are very interested in innovation. And so one of the things we do on this podcast is we're going to be talking to interesting people. And so today we're going to start off with the news, and then right after that we've got an interview with Josepha Haden, who is the executive director of the WordPress project at Automattic. And I had an amazing conversation with her at WordCamp Phoenix. In the news today, we've got some discussion about PHP versions reaching end of life, what proportion of hacked CMSs are WordPress, freemius patching a severe vulnerability, Chrome zero-day vulnerability was actively being attacked and probably still is, and that's pretty serious, so we'll get to that, a discussion about making major WordPress release cycles more predictable, and CoinHive is shutting down. I know some of the security researchers watching this will be celebrating that little event. CoinHive supports a miner that was used by malware authors to mine Monero. And then right after that, we've got our interview with Josepha. So get ready for an awesome podcast. All right, diving into the news. Kathy, you're in Phoenix right now, right?
Yeah, it's lunchtime here right now, and I'm taking a little bit of a break from Phoenix Startup Week, where I'm visiting with a few friends who have some startup businesses and talking to them about security and all that fun stuff. So happy to take a break and talk to you, though, Mark.
Awesome. And I think the weather there is probably a little bit better. It's about 45 here and sunny, so not too freezing.
Yeah, it's going to be 80 here today, so I won't rub that in.
Nice. All right. Well, jumping right in. So WordPress 5.1 was released recently. It included an amazing feature called Site Health, which notifies you of out-of-date versions of PHP. WordPress will actually work with PHP 5.2.4, but you really don't want to run WordPress with PHP version 5 point anything. Right now, the WordPress team are recommending PHP 7.3 or greater, which is what we recommend. And there's a very specific reason for that. So looking at the 7 branch of PHP right now, 7.1 was end of life 3 months ago, and it stops receiving security updates in 8 months. 7.2 is end of life 8 months from now and loses security updates in 1 year and 8 months. And then 7.3 is actively supported right now for another year and 8 months and loses security updates in 2 years and 8 months. And so it's kind of obvious which version of PHP you want to be running, or rather which version of PHP you want your host to be running. And it's 7.3. Kathy, there's a way to tell what PHP version you're on that's pretty easy, right?
There is an easy way to do it. If you're running Wordfence and go into Tools and the Diagnostics page, it will give you an overview of a number of things about your site, and one of those things is the important factor of what version of PHP you're running. So that's a quick and easy way to find out what version your site is on. And if you're unsure of how to upgrade, talk to your hosting provider. That's one of the things they can take care of and at least guide you in the right place if they're not going to do that for you.
Awesome. All right. And then I guess we got some news from the security team published on ZDNet that says that WordPress accounted for 90% of all hacked CMS sites in 2018.
Yeah, that was an interesting statistic. This came out March 5th, and it had a link to Sucuri's hacked website report. And interestingly, there were a couple of interesting data points that came out. The big news is that WordPress is accounting for 90% of all hacked CMS, but it also accounted for a lot more of the CMS or content management systems that they were seeing brought in. So more people are using WordPress, They also saw that the commerce platforms like PrestaShop were not being updated as frequently as WordPress. WordPress updates were actually happening much more frequently than what they've seen in years past, and I found that to be an interesting statistic. Because as more WordPress sites are being patched and updated, that that number of hacked WordPress sites should start to go down as more people are focusing on security. It's always good to see what other security firms are seeing come through their business.
Yeah, for sure. So kudos to our colleagues at GoDaddy and in the security team for that research.
Yeah.
All right. So Freemius patched a severe vulnerability in a library used by popular WordPress plugins. This is from WP Tavern on March 1st, so a little less than a week ago. And you can find coverage on that on the WP Tavern site or the Freemius blog. The library is used by numerous plugins and themes, including NextGen Gallery, which is over 1 million installs, the 404 to 301 plugin, which is over 100,000 installs, WP Security Audit Log, 80,000 installs, and Foo Gallery, over 100,000 installs. The vulnerability is a authenticated, is an option injection vulnerability. Basically, the way it works is if you have an account on a WordPress site, and you can go in and exploit this vulnerability, and it allows you to modify the options table in WordPress to modify what happens when a new account is registered. And so the attacker can go in and create an account, exploit the vulnerability, make the modification, and then create new accounts with admin access. And so this vulnerability is fairly serious because it lets attackers gain full admin access on a WordPress site. Now, there's a little bit of controversy around this, and Kathy, I think you're in the loop on what that is.
Yeah, well, you know, okay, so the people who develop Freemius, this is, you know, a library, it's not a plugin. When they realized that this vulnerability existed, I mean, with anyone who realizes that they have a security concern, the first reaction, obviously, is panic, right? And so they, you know, I don't know what kind of plan they had in place in order to, you know, go through the process of responsibly ensuring that, you know, patches were applied as quickly as possible in a safe way as possible. But they publicly posted in GitHub the update and had the word security in that update, and it was picked up by a security researcher who then, you know, went and investigated that vulnerability and developed a proof of concept showing how that vulnerability could be exploited. And because of the way it was disclosed, it didn't have a private disclosure to all of the plugins and applications that were using this library, the security researcher kind of jumped the gun and published how to basically get into sites very quickly, which made things just, you know, we started seeing in our site cleaning business a number of exploits coming in. And, you know, it's the security industry, Mark, you've been in it for much longer than I have. I mean, I kind of come from the WordPress world. This is kind of like the old Wild West days of security, wasn't it?
Yeah. So there's, for a long, long time, and this is going back to the 90s, there was a very adversarial relationship between security researchers or professionals, enthusiasts. You know, some of them, in some cases, were just kids that found security holes. And there's kind of an adversarial relationship between the security folks and vendors. And that extended well into the 2000s. And then as we had companies that provided pen testing and bug bounties and so on become more popular, companies like HackerOne and BugCrowd and that kind of thing, the way that vulnerabilities were disclosed by security researchers to vendors has become standardized. And it's kind of become business as usual. You know, the security researcher will disclose the vulnerability confidentially to the vendor. They will agree on a timeline. The vendor will release a fix to their customers. And on that agreed timeline, the security researcher will eventually publish their research. And that's the reward for the researcher, is that they get to say, hey, I'm the guy who, or person who discovered this vulnerability. And here's the full details of my amazing research. And the vendor benefits because, of course, they end up with a more secure product. And more importantly, their customers end up with a more secure product. And so that's really well established now. And that communication happens in a very relaxed way. And the days of researchers saying, oh my God, you're an idiot. I found a vulnerability in your software and look at how much of an idiot you are that you wrote this vulnerability. Now look at my amazing blog post of how dangerous this vulnerability is. those days are over.
Right.
At least mostly over.
Well, I mean, I think the collaborative approach that we have now, where security researchers are putting the needs of the customer first, rather than putting, you know, their research into like the limelight, it really serves the industry as a whole. I mean, the days of like shaming someone for coding practices or shaming someone because of, I mean, everybody makes mistakes, right? Everybody has new vulnerabilities that are disclosed. I mean, if I look back at, you know, my code from like 10, 20 years ago, there's probably a security vulnerability. I mean, I didn't know when I first started coding. I mean, I didn't know what a security or a SQL injection was. But as soon as I knew, you know, let's go rewrite everything and sanitize, right? But
totally.
So mistakes happen, and for us to like shame people because of a mistake or just because there's a security vulnerability serves absolutely no one. It may serve the security researcher, but it doesn't serve the customers. It doesn't serve the community as a whole, and it doesn't serve, you know, it doesn't serve the projects that are serving, you know, humanity that exist on the web that are being supported by WordPress and other applications. So, you know, this was unfortunate, but I do think that there's lots of lessons in what Freemius went through, and I definitely think if you are developing any software whatsoever, that blog post that they wrote is a heartening read. Mark, do you have any recommendations like of what, like if you are responsible for a code library or for a plugin, should people have a plan in place for when security vulnerabilities are found, like what they should do? Are there best practices?
Yeah, so I think that the best thing a vendor can do is familiarize yourself with how the security disclosure process works. And there's a lot that's been written about that. You know, Kathy and I are having an impromptu conversation about it, so we might throw something up on the blog that describes our view of, well, not our view, it's actually really an industry view of how a responsible disclosure works. And I think for a vendor to familiarize themselves with that process will allow them to understand what the baseline is, you know, how this is normally done, so that if they are working with a researcher and the researcher kind of goes off on their own and is inventing a process, you know that that's happening, and you can say, well, hold on, you know, there's this established process. Why don't we look at that and use something like that? So yeah, we'll give that some more thought on our side and perhaps put something up on the blog. But I think the message here is that there are established norms, both for the security vendor and for the researcher. And I think looking at those and conducting or putting together a timeline based on those is going to keep everyone a lot more relaxed and sane and less stressed out. And it's most importantly going to serve the customer way, way better. The customer is going to end up being more secure. And that's who I think we all care about the most, whether you're a researcher or you're a vendor. You know, you really, in all cases, are serving the end user, whether that those end users are businesses or individuals. And so our goals are aligned, guys.
Totally.
Our goals are... All right, well, on to the next item. So there's a Chrome zero-day vulnerability that was under attack by the time the Chrome team found out about it. This was covered in ZDNet on March 6th, which was yesterday, I think, wasn't it? Oh, no, that's today. So you can read the story there, and we'll put the link in the show notes, but it's a bad one. It's a memory management vulnerability, and it is related to the File Reader API, which is a web API included in all major browsers that lets web apps read the contents of files stored on a user's computer. And of course, that is done in a sandbox normally. So you can imagine how a bug might have introduced this vulnerability and allowed attackers to actually run code on the underlying OS. So it's a worst case scenario. It's basically an RCE, a remote code execution vulnerability. And It is bad enough that Justin Xu, the Chrome security lead, tweeted about this recommending an update, and that doesn't happen very often. And Justin was like, update now, drop everything, basically. So definitely take a look at that, and you will need to update to Chrome 72.0.3626.121. I love Chrome's versioning system. It's so clear. But anyway, yeah, and we'll include that incredibly long version number in the show notes as well. But if you want to, you can actually turn on auto updates. And I must admit, when we were chatting about this right before the show, Kathy told me that you can do that. And I'd like to think that deep in my subconscious, I knew that you could do that, but I had forgotten. And when I went to go and check, I have auto updates on, so I wasn't in a bad place. But Kathy, for everyone else, and perhaps me one more time, how do you turn on auto updates in Chrome?
I only knew because I read this article very early this morning, and I said, well, I better go figure that out. So I went under About Google Chrome on the Mac, under the top nav under there. And then that's also the place where you can update, and you'll have to relaunch. And it's also where you can turn on auto updates if you want to do that.
Awesome. And when I went there, when we were chatting, I clicked on About, and lo and behold, Chrome was downloading an update. And I think that clicking on About might actually trigger a download, but I don't know that for sure. It just seemed like awfully coincidental. So, all right. Anyway, I'm rambling. Let's move on to the next thing. Kathy, you were looking at a discussion about tightening up major release cycles to make them more predictable in the WordPress community, right?
Yeah, I actually saw the discussion occurring on make.wordpress.org, and then WP Tavern wrote about it the next day on February 28th. And there is a push to have release cycles more predictable and more regular for the WordPress core team. The drive for this is coming from a number of contributors. And there's a couple of major reasons why. First of all, I mean, everybody who's contributing to the WordPress project is a volunteer, right? They're contributing their time and expertise. To make that less stressful and easier and more predictable, they're talking about doing more frequent and regular updating of the WordPress core. And the goal, the second reason why that it's this, which is even more important and has the security angle, which is why we're talking about it, is this will make it more comfortable for end users to enable automatic updates for WordPress. And when they do something like that, then obviously security patches are automatically applied. When you have more drastic changes in a software product, end users are much more likely to not want to have automatic updates. I know I don't want automatic updates to occur if there's going to be a drastic change. I mean, could you imagine if the WordPress editor just, Gutenberg automatically showed up on your site and you were logging in and it's like, oh, this is so different. So those drastic changes spook end users, and for security reasons, they're really looking at some of the larger projects like Firefox and their development cycles. It also makes documentation a lot easier to write when you have more predictable release cycles, which
for sure.
I think that's something that a lot of developers can learn from. But it's going to be obviously beneficial, not only for contributors, but the end user as well.
All right, sounds good. Well, break out the champagne. I have amazing news for you. CoinHive is shutting down. Yes!
Yay!
And my apologies to the CoinHive team. I'm sure you had big dreams when you created your application. I think the original intent there was that CoinHive was a way to mine Monero currency in the web browser. And so the idea was that websites would put this Monero mining code on their site, and when a visitor arrived on the site, the plugin that was installed on a site would use the browser's CPU to mine Monero. And Monero is a little bit different because you can very effectively mine it using a regular CPU. You don't have to use a GPU. So it's particularly well suited for this business model that that CoinHive implemented. Well, it turns out that CoinHive became most popular with malware authors. And over and over and over, our site cleaning team would see sites that have been compromised where the first thing the attacker does is put Monero mining code in the form of CoinHive on the site. and the visitors' browsers would be leveraged to mine Monero using the CoinHive JavaScript code, and any proceeds would be deposited in the attacker's account. And so this became a very, very sort of favorite tool of hackers to earn money. It was a brand new business model that emerged, and CoinHive was at the center of it. And so what happened is, I guess there's been a bit of a collapse in cryptocurrencies, and there's also been some activity in terms of forking and that kind of thing, which has disrupted CoinHive's business model. And so they have decided that they're going to shut down. And the shutdown date is the 8th of March, which is 2 days from now, from the time of filming. So celebrate, pop your champagne if you're a security researcher, if you are a team member of CoinHive. That sucks. I'm actually really sorry to hear that for you. I'm a company founder too, so I do feel your pain. But in the InfoSec world, we are quietly celebrating. So that's happening. So it'll be interesting to see what attackers do after this, right, Kathy? If there's a new model that emerges for mining cryptocurrency in the browser.
Yeah, well, cryptocurrencies need to get more valuable again in order for there to be an incentive to do so. I think that Sakuri's GoDaddy research that we cited earlier, seeing a resurgence of SEO spam, maybe because of that, you know. I think SEO spam was kind of going down back when I was doing site cleaning, and when the CoinHive miners started showing up. And now it seems to be going back the other way. Who knows?
Yeah.
What may be next?
Remember the good old days back in the 90s when hacking was all about exploring, and now it's about money. So, you know, there's various business models, whether it's ransomware or mining cryptocurrency on a compromised site or SEO spam. You know, they're constantly moving from one business model to another, and we'll certainly track that over here. All right, Kathy, thank you so much for the chat. We'll just move right into our interview. I have an amazing interview today to share with you. It's Josepha Haden. Josepha is Executive Director of WordPress at Automattic, and that new position for her was announced on January 15th of this year, so not too long ago. I had an awesome chat with Josepha at WordCamp Phoenix, which was a little bit less than 2 weeks ago, I think. And her role right now is to oversee and direct all contributor teams in their work to build and maintain WordPress. So it is a big deal. It's a big role. And she's joining the role at a very interesting time in the evolution of WordPress. We had WordPress 5.0 released towards the end of last year, which of course included Gutenberg, which is a very, very powerful editor and a wonderful change for WordPress. But it was also a bit of a traumatic process to get there. And we had, for example, the lead of the accessibility team resigned because there was some objections in terms of the way things were unfolding with Gutenberg. And in chatting with Josepha, we chatted about that, and she chatted about a path forward for WordPress contributors and folks that are involved in the community. Obviously, she's doing a lot of thinking about that. It's a great interview. Here is Josepha Haden at WordCamp Phoenix.
So my name is Josepha Haden Champosi. I've been in the WordPress community since 2009, 2010, something like that. And I am currently the executive director of the WordPress project. So very exciting. My origin story is one of the favorite things for me to talk about because it involves my mother. So ages and ages ago in 2009, I was a starving artist at the time. I was trying to be a musician in a city that it turns out was completely filled with musicians who are far better than me. And I was calling my mom, letting her know that I was going to come home for the weekend. And she said, that's fine, but I'm going to this conference. I have an extra ticket if you want to join. And I said, a conference sounds like a party, so yeah, I'll go to that. So I went to WordCamp in Fayetteville, Arkansas, WordCamp Fayetteville, 2009. And didn't know anything that anyone was talking about, and ended up feeling really out of my depth the entire time. But as soon as we were finished, my mom said, you know, if you are going to be a famous singer someday, like, you need a website, so maybe we should figure this out together. So my mom, who had been building websites and working in SEO for a couple of years by that point, built me my first WordPress website and put all the content on it and got everything going. And she taught me basically everything that I knew to get started on working inside WordPress as a CMS. And so the reason that I am here is because my mom taught me about WordPress, introduced me to WordPress, and yeah, the rest is history. So the first progression that I had was noticing that there wasn't a community like that in my city. I don't live in Fayetteville. I live in Kansas City. And so the first thing that I did was try to figure out if that same community existed where I was, and it didn't. And so I started the WordPress community in Kansas City and sort of got the meetup group started and helped to organize their WordCamp for a number of years. And then in 2012, went to WordCamp San Francisco, which was the precursor to WordCamp US, which everybody knows, and met huge numbers of people who really shaped my desire to be involved in this project. Like, when you first start using WordPress, you have no idea that this community exists in the way that it does, with all of these people who like actively work on it, but also are trying so hard to take care of each other and make the right choices for the future of the open web and all this stuff. And so being able to meet all of these really interesting people who had these interesting philosophical ideas about technology and what you can do with it and how it can change the world, like, I was so motivated to get involved with the WordPress project at that point, because they just had such interesting ideas about how WordPress could be an agent of change for good in the world. And I mean, who could say no to that? So cool. Oh, I am so glad you asked. So, how WordPress can be an agent of change. Before I started the work that I do now, which is kind of managing the WordPress project and helping everybody know how to contribute and give back to things better, I did a lot of education and training around WordPress, and I really think that in order to be able to help people change their life circumstances, you have to meet them where they are. And so many of the people that use WordPress in order to market their services or to sell things and have passive income, so many of those people otherwise would not be able to make a living without what WordPress provides to them. And so being able to take people who either were just stuck at home for whatever reason, or otherwise not able to go out and get a job, a well-paying tech job, to give them an opportunity to level the playing field for their future and for the future of the children that they're raising and the people who are looking to them as role models, like, that is a remarkably powerful thing to be able to do, not only as a teacher and an educator, but also as someone who's working with this community and with this tool. So this also started at a WordCamp. I went to WordCamp San Francisco in 2014 and participated in my first ever contributor day, and also, I believe, in my first ever just kind of round table discussion about the questions that I think a lot of the people in the community have then and they still have now. Things like how to get more diverse voices available in the development process and in the overall building of the thing. And so I was involved with that for the first time ever. I met the entire team that Automatic employed at the time to work in the community, and Jen Milo, who is one of our essentially architects of the way this program works, asked me if I'd ever considered doing this kind of work for pay. And like, obviously, I have been working in nonprofits for a long time. And so, yeah, the idea that I could do this for a project that was so valuable, as far as I could tell, to the world at large, and do it because someone valued those skills and was prepared to pay me, like, of course I would do that. And so we started the interview process, and which was lengthy and terrifying, and I had to have my final interview with Matt Mullenweg, who just, it was the most terrifying thing I'd ever done to date, but now is my direct boss, so I guess it's all okay. So that's how I got started at Automatic. I was an individual part of a larger team, and I was working on the meetup program at the time. And then Jen left Automatic and I took over that entire team. And then I grew into the core team, which I led for about a year. And now I lead our entire open source practice at Automatic. Yeah, that's been about a year. And it's been a really rewarding experience. The people that I work with are just, they're so insightful. And they bring such joy to the work that they do that like I would support them in their work to the ends of the earth. They're so great. My first and most pressing goal for me is to take some action on the feedback that I've been hearing from the community for the past couple of years. There, with the introduction of Gutenberg, there was some discomfort in the community. And I spent a lot of time listening to what it was about that process that was so uncomfortable for so many people. And I actually just started a series of posts that kind of uncovers what it is that we could, as people who are being stewards of this community, do better for people who are just trying to do their best volunteer work that they possibly can. And so my immediate goals are to help us get kind of an infrastructure that will help us succeed and surpass expectations over the next 15 years. Anytime that you have such a broad and interesting organism as we have with WordPress, like what got you to year 15 will never get you 15 years into the future after that. And so we're just trying to keep an eye on where the biggest pain points are right now so that we can help people get comfortable in how to commit their time and for us to continue to be respectful of the time that people are prepared to give to us. So some infrastructural changes are on my immediate playlist for the community. My overall concept of what we can do within the next 3 years, which is literally as far out as I've dared to dream, I really think that one of the first things that we as WordPress the tool can do and should do is continue to make our tool usable for the most number of people. Because I do think it is something that can change life circumstances for the better if we do it right. And while WordPress is the easiest CMS option out there, it is not actually easy to get started with. It's confusing, it's slightly terrifying if you don't already know what you're looking for, and if you aren't brave around technology. And that's something that we should be aware of. And so I think that for WordPress, the CMS, is gonna be our biggest focus over the next 3 years. For WordPress, the community, I think that finding a way for all of these teams that we have to operate and work in a way that lets them have some comfort in the fact that what they're working on is going to be heard and seen and valued, like just uncovering why they belong here in the first place, I think is gonna be our biggest long-term hurdle. And I don't think it's insurmountable, because this community really cares about each other and it cares about how we all work together. And so yeah, a bit of more widespread usable tool and a bit of more widespread gratitude and clear definitions of who's working on what where, I think is what we have going in those two spaces. I think that a couple of the foundational things that got us through the difficult transition into working with Gutenberg that will absolutely continue to get us further is continuing to have this adherence to wanting to have more open communication. I know that the community has been calling for transparency a lot, and I agree. But there has started to be this really interesting conversation around the nuanced characteristics of transparency as they exist in a gigantic group like we are. And so I'm really interested for the community to continue to explore that. But also, I think that one of the things that really let us band together while we do anything that's uncomfortable for us is this constant desire to do something better. And like understanding that no one else that we're working with in the community is trying to come up with a bad choice, right? Like every volunteer that shows up to fight about something or to have a bold discussion in a Slack channel or on one of our websites, all of those people are just fighting to have the best solution for the people that they are most able to help and most want to help. And making sure that all of us understand that part of who makes us, of what makes us the community that we are, I think is going to be the most important part to get us through the next 15 years, frankly. I almost said 3 years because that's what you said earlier, but I was like, no, this is a lifetime journey for a lot of these people. Like, this is a love and desire and passion that they all have, and I want to be able to help them foster it and steward it in an excellent way for a long time.
All right, I'd like to thank Josepha very much for the time that she spent chatting with me at WordCamp Phoenix. I really enjoyed our conversation, and I look forward to seeing things as they develop going forward in the WordPress community and in her new role. That pretty much wraps it up for this week's podcast. If you'd like to follow Kathy, you can follow her at Kathy Zant on Twitter, and you can follow me at M Maunder. That's M-M-A-U-N-D-E-R. Thank you very much for spending time with us today, and we'll see you in roughly a week. Bye.